Father, this is a prayer tonight. Our prayer is that you would settle here. We have some particular places that we need you to settle. Some of us need to settle in our hearts. Some of us need you to settle in our houses. Oh God. Oh God. This is our prayer tonight. Unify our hearts, Lord. Unify.
Hallelujah. We thank you for joining us here at Light of the World Church. Amen. We're sorry for the lateness of the hour. Amen. Due to technical difficulties, we had a few problems. But we bless the Lord for being in the house of the Lord. One more time, we're gathered together in the name of the Lord. And tonight, we are Light of the World Church, amen, a church where everybody is somebody and Christ is all, amen. Our overseer is Apostle Johnny O. Jones, amen. We thank God for him. We thank God for Lady Jones, amen. I am Pastor Tim Brown. We thank God for First Lady Brown tonight, amen. Evangelist Taranja Sampson, our assistant pastor, amen. We bless the Lord for you joining us, amen, due to the lateness of the hour. We thank you, amen, for still joining us right here, amen, at Light of the World Church, amen. Again, a church where, amen, everybody is somebody and Christ is all. On tonight, we bless the Lord, amen. If you'd like to give to this ministry, amen, you may do so, amen, you may do so, amen. At our Cash App, amen, our Cash App is $, amen, light 4701. That's $ light, L-I-G-H-T, 4701. Amen. You also may give online at PayPal. That is www.paypal, amen, .me/LOTWC Church. Again, that's www.paypal.me/LOTWC Church. You also can give online giving at Tithely, amen, tithely.ly. Also, amen, you may mail in your seeds and offering, amen, to our physical address, which is 4701 North 15th Street in Tampa, Florida. Also, you may mail to our P.O. Box, amen. Our P.O. Box is 75782 Tampa, Florida, 33675. Amen, that's P.O. Box 75782 Tampa, Florida, 33675. Amen, we bless the Lord. Amen, we're just gonna pray right now. Amen. Father, in the precious name of Jesus, God, we thank you for another day. God, another day that, God, that you have blessed us, another day closed in our right mind. God, another day you have caused us, God, to open our eyes and give you thanks, God. We, another day, God, that you have given us, God, the activities of our limbs. And we just want to say thank you on tonight. We just want to say thank you, God, for your power, for your grace, and God, for your mercy. Now, Father, we ask, God, that you visit us, God, with wisdom, God, knowledge, and understanding, that your people, God, may be blessed and fed of your word. God, we ask you to go into their homes. God, let your angels of mercy, God, touch them. God, even in this hour, God, that you bless, heal, deliver, and set free. In the precious name of Jesus. And Father, we will forever thank you and give you the glory, and give you, amen, the honor. Amen. We are still in our Bible study series on tonight. We're still in our Bible study series on tonight, amen, moving from defeat, amen, to winning. From defeat, amen, to winning. And we're going into session 4 tonight, amen, session 4. Amen. Blessed be the name of God. Amen. Session 4. Amen. Glory be to God. Session 4. Amen. Loving the enemy. That's what we're going to be dealing with tonight. Amen. Loving the enemy. All right. We're going to be coming from Matthew chapter 5. Amen. Verse 44. Amen. Chapter 5, verse 44. Amen. You turn your word of God with us on tonight. Amen. And it says, "But I say unto you, love your enemies. Bless them that curse you. Amen. Do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you. Amen. All right, so we'll read that one more time. But I say unto you, amen, love your enemies. Bless them that curse you. Do good to them that hate you. And pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you. Amen. All right. And we're going to Proverbs 25, verses 21 and 22. If thy enemy be hungry, give him bread to eat. And if he be thirsty, give him water to drink. For thou shalt heap coals of fire upon his head, and the Lord shall reward thee. On tonight, the subject, loving the enemy. All right? And so, even in this pandemic, amen, this pandemic has been said, amen, earlier in our sessions, earlier in other life studies, amen, this pandemic has, amen, played a mental state on the whole earth, amen, on the whole world. And so, when we deal with this pandemic, we're dealing with the mental state, amen, of every individual, amen, from being closed up in closed quarters at home and getting back out into society, amen, we're dealing with the mental state, amen, of every individual. But we as people of God, the Bible tells us, amen, he will keep us, amen, in perfect peace, whose mind is staying fast on him. And when our mind stayed fast on him, and when our mind stayed fast on the Lord, amen, we still have to deal and still have to represent God, amen, in a good fashion, as being people of God, as being saints of God, as being one that are called out and separated from everybody else. And so, in the area of our lives, amen, last week we talked about the power of forgiveness and the power of confession. Amen. And so if we're going to move, amen, from the area of defeat or a position of defeat to a position of winning, we have to, amen, tonight look at loving our enemies. Now, we understand this flesh part of us don't want to love our enemies. This flesh part of us don't want to deal with anybody that has done us wrong. The natural course of action of every human being is to protect him or herself, is to protect him or her family. Amen. And so that's the natural, amen, course of action, amen, is for this flesh, amen, to launch out and protect itself, and protect our loved ones, and protect those that are around us, protect our family members, amen? And so, with dealing with this subject, this is a strategic subject, a tense, amen, subject, even in the house of the Lord. So, how do we deal with our enemy? How do we deal with our enemies to the fact, amen, and to the way that we're not being defeated, and God cannot move for us. God cannot do miracles for us because our hearts is not right. The Bible tells us nothing, amen, but the pure in heart shall see God. And so our hearts have to be pure, our minds have to be pure, amen, to see the Lord, to see the goodness of the Lord. And I will see the goodness of the Lord. Amen. And so we're going to look at this tonight, how loving our enemies, amen, plays a very important part for moving from the area of defeat, amen, to the area of winning. Look at this. As Christians, we are required to perform the difficult duty of loving those whose conduct we do not approve of. Those who make our lives difficult. Loving our enemies can turn them into friends by placing hot coals on their head. However, even when we are not able to turn them around, it benefits us greatly not to hate others, because it harms us by filling our spirits with resentment, vindictiveness, stress, and misery. A heart full of love ensures a healthy system with an even pulse, good digestion, and ability to sleep soundly. Love also imparts clear judgment, compassion, enthusiasm, development of skills, and growth in faith. Amen. Watch this. Martin Luther King said this statement: love is the only force capable of transforming an enemy into a friend. I'll say that one more time. Stated by the love, the late great Martin Luther King Jr. says, love is the only force capable of transforming an enemy into a friend. So why should we love our enemies? All right, why should we love? Why should we have to deal with our enemies? Why should we have to deal with someone that don't like us? Why should we have to deal with someone that don't want to be associated with us? Watch this. Number one, you'll be happier. If you have anger and resentment inside of you, even if you don't think about it all the time, there are times when it surfaces. Notice what we said on a couple of weeks ago. You have to kill these things that are in your life. The Bible says for us to lay aside in every way that so easily besets us. And so if you take out the thing and you remove the thing, amen, that's causing you harm and that's defeating you, it will not surface at any time. Notice a dead man, you can walk up to a cadaver, you can walk up to a dead person, and you can slap them and they won't say a word. You can take a knife and stick it in their side, and he or she won't say a word. Why? Because they are dead. They are dead and they have no feelings. They have, amen, no blood pumping through their veins. And so with that, amen, blessed be to God, that feeling, amen, will not surface. And so why are we giving you that analogy tonight? We're giving you that analogy to the simple fact is, when you have the agape love of God in your heart, it is not to say you're not going to feel. It is not to say you're not going to hurt. It is not to say that you're not at some time want to hurt and have pains about the situation. But what the love of God does, the love of God takes that seed that is in the heart. The love of God takes that seed, amen, out, and it can no more bring forth life. It is dead. And so when you have resentment and when you have anger, amen, in your heart, it brings forth other things such as stress and all of these sicknesses and diseases, amen, caused by stress, amen, that affect our bodies, amen, and therefore we cannot serve God in the full capacity, amen, that we should. And that's simply the job of the enemy, to come many ways and use many devices, amen, to stop us from serving God, to stop us from getting to our potential in God, to stop us from getting to our goals in God. And so it's an avenue, amen, that the enemy uses, that we don't love our enemies, and ultimately, that ultimate end result, amen, we are defeated and we can't win in Christ. How can God use us, amen? How can he use us when we're so burdened down? How can he use us when we're so full of ailments? And so the Bible tells us, amen, that he will give us perfect peace, amen, whose mind is steadfast on him. And so God, he says, I wish that you prosper, amen, and be in good health, even as your soul prospers. And so not loving your enemy puts a halt on your soul from prospering. Not loving your enemy, amen, causes anger and causes resentment. And that seed of anger, that seed, amen, of resentment causes stress to come in your natural body, and you cannot fulfill the things that God wants you to fulfill. Why? Because you're trying to patch up, amen, this natural body. And so that happens to you unhappy. It's destructive. Inwardly, it eats you up. And outwardly, it may bring destruction to things, to others. That anger also affects others around you, all right? Such as your loved ones, who are most likely, amen, affected in some way when you are angry, all right? So when you are frustrated and when you are angry because of something or someone has done something to you, that anger and resentment spills over, amen, to your spouse, your children, amen, to your fellow Christians, to your fellow bodies of Christ members, amen. And all they can feel, they don't know what's wrong. All they can feel is the anger and the resentment. And so why allow someone, amen, to get you out of character? Why allow someone to interrupt your world of peace? Why allow the enemy, amen, to defeat you when you can simply use the love of God, get over and win? All right? Look at somebody and say, I'm going to get over it, and I'm going to win. No longer will this person hold me hostage in the area of defeat. You ought to type it on the screen tonight and say, I'm going to get over it, and I'm going to win. I'm going to get over it, and I'm going to win. Look at this. You can change that person's life. Loving your enemy can literally change their life. Why? Why do you say that, man of God? Because loving the enemy, loving your enemy will say, well, I laid a trap for them. I dug a hole for them. I wanted them to not succeed, but yet they're succeeding. Yet they're still loving me when I'm talking about them. Yet they're still loving me when I put a trap down for them. All right? And so loving your enemy can confuse them and can literally change their life. Watch this. Your enemy is a human being, and it is very possible that your hatred for that person is the source of grief and tension or hatred in them. Now that you feel good, now that might feel good to you in a vindictive way, but if you look at it objectively, watch this, removing your feelings from the situation, hurting another person is always a bad thing. Make them happier is a good thing, and interestingly, making someone happier, no matter who it is, can make us happier. Amen. Number three, you can make a friend. Now, the Word of God says you will heap coals of fire, amen, upon their head. And so their mind and their thoughts begin to turn and say, wow, I laid this trap for them, I've done this hurt for them, but yet they're still loving me. I laid this trap for them, and they're still loving me. They're still treating me with kindness. They're still treating me with love. Ah, look what the Word of God says. It says, with love and kindness, have I drawn thee? And so it is the love and it is the kindness of God that draws us to him. Now, it is the loveness, the Bible says, greater is he that is in thee than he that is in the world. And so we ought to have a little bit more love than our enemy. We ought to have a little bit more love than those that persecute us and those that talk about us. And so, what does that do? It makes your enemy wonder, who is your God? It makes your enemy wonder, how can they keep going? How can they keep smiling? And how can they keep having success? Why? Because you have the godly love of God. You have the godly love of God down on the inside. And what that does, that can turn your enemy into a friend. And that very enemy would be the one that lays down his life for you. That enemy could be the one that protects you from harm and protects you. And God will place it on the heart. Amen. To be a armor bearer for you. Look at this. One of the most powerful effects of learning to love your enemies is that your enemy can become, amen, your friend. And while it is counterproductive to be fighting with the enemy, it hinders your progress. So that's where we're, amen, keep being defeated. Amen. Why? Because we're spending so much time, amen, trying to fight our enemy. We're spending so much time trying to get back at them. We're spending so much time that it stops our progress with God. It stops our growth. It stunts our growth with God. And God is looking and saying, son, daughter, I love your enemy, but you're saying, no, I can't. And you're spending so much energy. You're spending so much time, amen, fighting your enemy when you can spend time and then loving them, and that helps you. Look at what the scripture says. God will, amen, not only he calls a fire upon their head, but he said, great is your reward. In other words, I will reward you, amen, for loving your enemy. So how can you keep going? God rewards you. How do you keep going when you feel, amen, not stopping? God gives you strength. How do you keep going, amen, and loving your enemy? Amen. You have to have the mind of God. Now, it takes the Spirit of God, amen, to love your enemy. For the Bible simply said, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for the ungodly. It was the agape love of God that calls, amen, Jesus Christ, amen, to get on the cross and die for our sin. It was the agape love of God. John 3:16 simply said, amen, for God so loved the world. He so, amen, somebody say so. He so loved the world. In other words, there was a great love he had for the world. Amen. Even from the Garden of Eden, amen, there was a great love God had for Adam. For the Bible tells us, amen, he came down, amen, every evening and talked with Adam and communed with Adam. For that great communication and that great love he had for mankindness. And so we ought to have that same love, amen, for our brother. Look, a new friend instead of an enemy makes an incredible difference. If that enemy is a family member or a former friend, reuniting can extremely be powerful and important. Amen. Now, situation, amen, or another a point, amen, of this lesson is, amen, you set, amen, a better example for others. Now, you set the example as a child of God, even for your brothers, even for your sisters, amen, and even for your enemies. Amen. And so, look at what it says. Amen. It sets a better example. When you can love your enemies, you're doing, amen, what the Bible requires you to do. Amen. It's going to take the power of God to help you do that. But you're setting such a great example because there's a lot of people, amen, don't pick up the Bible. There's a lot of people, amen, look towards, amen, those that are saying they are children of God to see what they're going to do, to see how, amen, they handle situations in their life. And so if we act like the sinner man, if we act like our enemy, how can we win them over to God? If we act like the world, how can we win them over to God? This is how the enemy keeps us defeated. Why? Because he tells us, Jesus told his disciples, he said, ye are my witnesses, even to the uttermost parts of the earth. And so he sent them out and commissioned them to be the witnesses of God, to be the witnesses of Jesus, to show the world that God loves, to show the world that he'll be with you, to show the world that he can deliver you, to show the world, amen, that he can set you free. And so we're the same witnesses in this earth. And so we are the ambassadors, amen, of Christ. You want to type on the screen, amen, I'm an ambassador of Christ. Now, here is the battle. Here is the battle of defeat and winning. So if the enemy can keep you in this area, he can keep you defeated. If he can keep you defeated, you can't be that ambassador of Christ. You can't be that witness that Jesus required you to be. And so, if you cannot be the witness that God has required you to be, you cannot win souls into the kingdom. Now you are defeated. Why? Because we were created to worship him. Not only were we created to worship him, but we were created to tell somebody about Jesus that souls can be brought into the kingdom. And so we're defeated in that area, amen, when we cannot bring souls into the kingdom and the purpose of the gospel and the purpose of Jesus Christ cannot be fulfilled in us, and yet then we are defeated and God cannot be glorified. And so, loving your enemies on tonight is a powerful, powerful tool that will remove you from defeat, amen, to winning. It is better for society, amen, and we can see that even in the world today, that it is better, amen, that we love one another. It is better, amen, that we treat one another with respect. It will be a better world. Watch this. It will be a better world if we can treat everyone with respect. It will be a better world if we can love one another as Christ has loved us. Amen. It will be a better society. Amen. Now, loving your enemy is a test of you as a person. Loving your enemy is a test of you as a person. You know, we don't find out who we really are until we face with trials and tribulation. And the Bible even tells us trials and tribulation, amen, amen, worketh patience. And letting patience have its perfect work. Amen. And so, unless there is a test, amen, unless there's a test, there cannot be a testimony. Say that again. Unless there's a test, there cannot be a testimony. All right. Now, look at this. You know, sometimes, amen, we pray and we ask God for patience. Sometimes we pray and we ask God to help our unbelief. Sometimes we pray and say, God, I need a little bit more faith. And when the trials come, we cry about the trials. We cry, amen, about the things that we're going through. And if God can talk to us, he will tell us, well, you asked me for more patience. In order for you to have more patience, I got to set a test in front of you. I got to set a trial in front of you. And so that very enemy could be your trial. That very person, amen, is the songwriter says, must Jesus bear the cross alone and all the world go free? There's a cross for you and there's a cross for me. The Bible puts it like this and said, take up your cross and follow me. In other words, he's saying, you're going to have a cross, amen, that you going to have to bear. And dealing with your enemy, amen, could be your cross tonight. Dealing with someone that aggravates you on a daily basis. This could be a co-worker, amen. And so dealing with that, you have to be in the right, you have to continuously, amen, keep this flesh under subjection, amen, and be in the right frame of mind, amen, to deal with that person. Do you have to sit with them? Do you have to congregate with them? No, but you can pray for them, amen. You can pray for them in your secret closet, and God will reward you openly. Look at this. Jesus brought up the issue of mercy repeatedly. Everyone wants mercy, but the Bible tells us that mercy triumphs over judgment. Of course, amen, we want it. Giving mercy requires us to give up revenge. Oh my God, I'll say that one more time. Giving mercy requires us to give up revenge and to hand the judgment part to God. Loving our enemies does not mean to allow them to continue to hurt us. Now we got to be wise. We got to be wise that we would be a failure of loving ourselves as God loves us. We can do what is in our control, amen, to protect ourselves while trusting God to step in. We can always pray for our enemies. Praying is an act of mercy. Praying is an act of mercy. Praying is loving like your heavenly Father, and prayer changes the heart. Amen. The songwriter says, prayer changes things. Amen. Now, you can say, man, why should I have to pray for them? Let's look at this. Jesus himself told the followers to pray for his enemies. You have heard this was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your neighbor and pray for those who persecute you. Amen. Matthew 5:43-44. He didn't suggest we like them or ignore them, but through our prayers, we bring them to the throne of God. Oh my God, that's so powerful. Through genuine prayer for your enemy, you bring them before the throne of God. And Jesus said, revenge is mine, and I will repay. All right? So we don't have to do anything but pray and bring them. I'm not talking about an evil prayer to kill them. I'm not talking about an evil prayer to do them harm, but a genuine prayer that God touched their heart and touched their mind. You bring them before the throne of God. All right? Matthew 5:45-48 says that you will be children of your Father in heaven. In other words, obeying this commandment marks us to be people related to the Almighty God. When people seeing you love, they have to recognize where the source of that love is coming from. If you can love your enemy that's constantly talking about you and doing you harm, and you keep showing them kindness, others around will look and see, look, What is the source? And they may even ask you, why do you keep treating that person right? Why do you keep treating that person with love? Now that opens a door for you to talk about God and say, I can do this because of the power of God. I can do this because of the love of God. All right? Jesus then added that if we pray for those who persecute us, it will be painful to them. As our enemies receive blessings via our prayers, they will feel miserable, weighed down with burning coals heaped on the top of their head, Romans 12:20. Because when someone is against you, they would expect you to retaliate. Turning the other cheek and petitioning God for your enemy needs is the last thing they will expect. How does praying for your enemy affect us? All right? So, we looked at how it would affect them. Amen. How would it affect you? As you pray for your enemies, we forgive them. Matthew 5:44 says to pray for those who persecute you. Ephesians 4:32 tells us to treat your enemy with kindness. Put away temptation to gossip or become bitter. Watch this. When you forgive those who are against you, we start to treat them differently, looking at them through the lens of compassion. Praying softens our heart as we let go our agenda, and the most of all allows us to become more like Jesus. Oh my God. To become more like Jesus. The more you become like him, the more you get close to him, the more he opens doors for you. The more you get close to him, the more he does for you. He opens your wisdom. He opens your knowledge. He opens everything. The Bible tells us, amen, tells us like this, that he has great things, amen, in store for us. It says, eyes have not seen, nor ears heard the things that God has prepared for them that love him and that are called according, amen, to his purpose. So if you haven't seen the great thing that God has for you when you love your enemy, when you truly walk in love, when you truly walk in peace, you haven't seen the great things that God's going to do for you. It moves you from the area of defeat and to the area of winning and open doors you have not seen and heard of. Amen. That you have not seen and heard of. I want you to write down 7 Bible verses. Amen. We might not read due to the lateness of the hour. Amen. We might not read them tonight, but I'm going to give you 7, amen, 7 Bible scriptures, 7 Bible verses that gives us perspective about praying for our enemies. And these scriptures, amen, is going to open up your wisdom and knowledge that why you should pray, amen, for your enemies. Amen. Number 1, Proverbs 16:7. Amen. Write that down. Proverbs 16:7. Number 2, Luke 23:34. Luke 23:34. Number 3, Romans 12:20-21. Amen. I'll give you a moment to catch up. Romans, number scripture number 3. That would give us perspective about praying for our enemies. Scripture number 3, amen. Romans 12:20-21. Romans 12:20-21. Amen. Number 4, 1 Peter 3:9. 1 Peter 3:9. Amen. 1 Peter 3:9. Amen. Number 5, Proverbs 20:22. Proverbs 20:22. Number 6, amen. Mark 11:25. Mark 11:25. And number 7, Matthew 5:44. Amen. Matthew 5:44. We're going to move on tonight. Amen. So those were 7 Bible verses, amen, that would give us perspective about praying for our enemies. Amen. Let you catch up for a moment. So, if you want to win tonight, if you want to move in the area of winning, amen, you have to tackle on the tactics of, amen, loving your enemy. Don't allow the enemy to keep you bound in this area. I tell you, people of God, when you can love someone that has done you wrong, if they call you and you can give them a piece of bread, or if they call you, you can give them, amen, a piece of money, amen, then you can give them food out of your house, or you can put them in a hotel and they just talk about you. That shows God where your heart is. That shows God that you truly want to be like Him. Being like God, I'm going to let you know tonight, being like God is a challenge. It's a challenge to us because our flesh, amen, wants to fight against doing the will of God. And our mind, naturally speaking, says to get back at that person or do the wrong thing. But I'm here to let you know tonight, if you can move out of this area, you can ask God, God, I need your help. I need you to help me get over this. I need you to help me. Amen. I don't went to my neighbor. I don't went to the person. I don't confess my sins. I don't forgive. Now I need to love them, God. God will work in your life, and you'll see the hands of God moving in your life. And that's the ultimate goal that allows us to win, when the hands of God moves in your life. Listen, quick testimony is this. Amen. Quick testimony is this, that you're going to need God to move in your life when you're in a situation that no one can help you. And you don't want, the songwriter says, I don't want no trouble at the river. In other words, he's saying, I don't want nothing, amen, hindering the hands of God from moving in my life. And if the hands of God had not moved in my life, amen, I would not be here. And so you cannot allow nothing. Paul said, what? Who shall separate me, amen, from the love of God? People of God, you cannot allow the enemy, amen, to keep you in this area of defeat, that the hands of God cannot move for you. You're going to need the hands of God. There's going to come a time in your life, amen, you're going to need the hands of God to move. Now, the great thing about God's grace and His mercy is that He is a forgiving God and He is a graceful God. And the Bible says the prayers of the righteous avail much. And so God will move in your life even off the prayers, amen, of the righteous. But I don't know about you, saints of God. I want that one-on-one contact with God. I love my brothers and my sisters praying for me. I love my leaders praying for me. But yet, I want that one-on-one contact, that one-on-one intimacy with God that I can know without a shadow of a doubt that He will move for me. When I was in the hospital, people of God, I had the no shadow of a doubt that God will bring me out. I had no shadow There was moments of weakness, yes. There was moments of fear. But my faith and my love and the power of the Word of God propelled me past my fear, prepared me past, so I became so comfortable with the fact that God, if this is the hour and if this is the time that my life would be over, I am comfortable enough to know without a shadow of doubt, I'll go with you, amen. I'll go back with you, amen. And my life is in good standing with you. And so when I came to that conclusion, it was the hand of God. I had to totally rely and trust on the power of God to move in my life. I did not have to lie there and wonder, well, did I do this right? I didn't have to lie there and wonder, oh, did I treat this person right? There was no shadow of a doubt in my mind that I did the right things when I was up, when I had my health, when I had my strength. I served God with all my ability, with all my mind, with all my might, with all my strength. I put everything in. People say, well, man, why are you at the church so many times? I have a connection with God like no other. And I love my time with God. I love my connection with God so that in that time of trials, that I was comfortable enough to say, God is my God and He is my peace. And I rely on Him to bring me out. I was just like them three Hebrews, boy. If He don't bring me out, I know that He's able to bring me out. And so my confidence in God, my love for God, the love for the Word, the power of the Word was brought me out. And so people, we have to move from this area and not allow the enemy, amen, to defeat us. We have to move from defeat to winning. All right? We got to move, amen, from defeat, amen, to winning. Amen. So that includes our session tonight. Amen. Lord, we'll be the same next week. We're going to set 5 Masters of the Universe. Oh my God, that's going to be a powerful session. Don't miss that. Masters of the Universe. All right, people of God, amen. And so we are winning tonight. We are miracles tonight.
You're looking at one.
You're looking at one. Right on the screen, you're looking at a miracle tonight. Amen. You're looking at a miracle tonight. Look at them and tell them you're looking at a miracle tonight. And we're going to move from the area of defeat to the area of winning. You may not be there to say, I'm going to love my enemy, but you got to pray and ask God to help me love my enemies. All right? So this is our closing song. Amen. You got to choose to do what's different. You got to tackle what's different. You got to speak what's different and allow God to move you in the era of winning. And when He moves you, you're going to be a miracle. When He moves you, you're going to have miracles in your life. All right? So let's listen to this. Amen. Life. They're not going to be able to explain what God is doing. come.
Amen. Be blessed, and we will keep you in our prayers.